Let's bring you this discussion now on this Wednesday morning. With the rising cost of living gripping almost all households in the country, the General Industries Workers Union of South Africa has made its own submissions to the National Wage Commission on proposed changes. Now, from the 1st of March this year, the minimum wage in South Africa was placed at around 27 Rand 48 cents, up from just over 25 Rand an hour. The union represents workers across various sectors, including food industry, mining, cleaning, and security. GIWUSA's president is Mametlwe Sebei, and he joins us now via our video link for more about their submissions. Great to have you on the program, sir. Thanks very much indeed for making time. And of course, our conversation takes place against the backdrop of what we all accept to be a crippling cost of living in the country. Just by glancing over your statement about this, you say you want the minimum wage to be increased to about 15,000 Rand a month. Take us through your thinking.
Absolutely. The reality is that, the current national minimum wage has absolutely no relation with the real cost of living, which not only remains high, but actually has been continuously increasing to unsustainable levels, with an increases in the cost of energy, both electricity and fuel, the cost of food always exceeding, you know, the average inflation rate, the cost of housing, and all the costs that workers spend most of their income on. And this includes transport and all the basic things that they require to survive. And we are saying that there has been a research that has been done to show that actually, the livable wage in South Africa is currently at 15,000. Now, that amount itself, by the way, does not cover a lot of things that has to do with the structure of the wage formation in a context of colonial, cheap migrant labor system. But nonetheless, we think it will be a major advance to the current pitiful and poverty wages that have condemned many workers to a constant struggle for survival, where they are unable to meet the most basic needs for food, electricity, municipal bills, as well as the cost of transport and other basic amenities and necessities of life.
Yeah, it's a noble endeavor, of course. I think many of us would agree that we want to live in a country where inequality is not as, you know, deep as it is in our country, and in a context where everybody can get by. But if my own calculations are anything to go by, Mr. Sebei, that would be a more than 100% increase of the current minimum wage. Is this something that the union genuinely believes can be achieved? And I know it's a bit of a cynical question to ask, but it's quite the jump.
It is. I mean, not only do we believe that, right? We remember a few years ago, we did initiate Outsourcing Must Fall campaign in universities where cleaners, you know, security guards and so on were earning at the region of about 2,500. In the case of University of Pretoria, for instance, we concluded an agreement that led to a 300% wage increase. Did that lead to a collapse of the university? Absolutely not. In actual fact, university was spending well over 10,000 rand minimum wage that we were demanding over a service provider that were contracted to, you know, provide security, cleaning, and, you know, landscaping and other outsourced services. Universities actually saved more whilst increasing the wages of the workers by 300%, right? And I was part of the mining, you know, strikes in 2012. The wages of the mine workers increased 5.5-fold almost since 2000, when they were around 60,000. Today, they are spending over 300,000, according to some estimates, right? In Marikana, where there was massacre alone, the wages actually between 2013 and 2021, they increased by about 90%, and that is 45% above the inflation rate in that period. Did the mining industry collapse? It has not, right? In actual fact, the mining industry increased their revenues fivefold. It has actually doubled their revenues just in the past 5 years alone. So the idea that the economy will collapse because of that is absolutely untrue. And also, it is refuted by statistics and the research in that field, which shows that, in actual fact, when you do increase minimum wages, the ILO research itself proved that when you increased minimum wages by 10%, generally it leads to 2.5% growth in the GDP and economic performance. So many of these workers that today we are talking about, by the way, are costing well above what they are paid. Take an example with many of these workers, cleaners, securities in hospitals, municipal, you know, government offices, cleaning schools, and all of that. You would find that actually they are being, or the service providers are actually charging government 22,000 for a worker that actually get paid 5,000 rand.
Right.
Now, this money is there in the economy because many employers, one or the other, are already paying it. The question is, to whom does this money actually goes?
Right.
Is that is repatriated by foreign-owned multinational corporations that are dominating our economy, or service providers that are parasitic? And when you give it to workers, that expand consumer spending, making sure that workers spend on food, clothing, and other basic in growing their local economies, and that can only be good for country and society at large.
Sure, that's one end of the spectrum, and I'm sure you've heard the debate on the other end, right? The fact that we're unlikely to see these companies, these multilateral corporations you cite, taking this lying down. If they are, in fact, eventually strong-armed through legislation or whatever the case may be, there is the other possibility of them industrializing, right? Replacing workers with machines, because ultimately that helps their bottom line.
Well, this is not true. I mean, when you look at the mining industry, right? Already the mining industry is well above that. I mean, take an example at Sibanye, where there was the massacre in 2012. By 2021, they were already actually paying a basic salary of, you know, approximately 15,000 rand, right? When you take a total package of remuneration to a worker was well above 20,000. Now, have these companies left? They have not. If anything, indications are that they've found ways of increasing renovation and productivity. And I think that's the reason that they have doubled their revenues in that period. And I can say, you know, we can debate a sector by sector. And I'll tell you what is the real problem is. The real problem is 30 years into democracy, we still have the basis of a capital accumulation in this country being a super exploitative regime of a cheap black migrant labor that we must undo if we have to, you know, grow the economy, because the poverty of the black working class is actually central to deindustrialization and to a colonial character of the economy that is export oriented and affords exports only a raw material, because there is simply no domestic market for a basic industrial products, right? Like the laptop that me and you are using to conduct this interview, the cell phones and all of the things, televisions, washing machines. No average worker can afford these things, where 60% of the workers are on the minimum wage, 75% are earning a pitiful wage of just above 6,000 rand a month and so on, which is below just even a food poverty line. And that's the reason that you have people in this country dying of starvation, others being killed scavenging for a waste food in the most industrialized country in the entire continent. That can be acceptable. And what's the reason that we need a transformation of the economy, dealing first and foremost with poverty wages, with the work regime, as well as, of course, creating jobs for many people. But on the basis of the current neo-colonial capitalist economy, that is not possible. And that's the reason that I think we also have to have broader conversation about how does the workers' movement seize power and transform society, both politically but also economically.
Yeah, I was about to say, it sounds to me that this is as much of a political question to be wrestled with as much as it is an economic one. But we'll leave it there for now. Plenty of food for thought, and I suppose many minefields that could lead to all kinds of debates. Mametlwe Sebei, always great engaging you, sir. Thank you very much indeed for your time. Mametlwe is the president of GIWUSA, that is the General Industries Workers Union of South Africa.